it's lovely to welcome such a buzzing, chatty church, everyone talking of each other and building community, which is really great. We're going to start as a preparation for our service, as we come to prepare ourselves to worship God. We're going to start with Be Still for the Presence of the Lord. So we'd like to stand and just use this song as a prayer as we begin this service to recognise God's presence with us. Loving God, we do thank you and praise you for your presence here with us this morning, that we can know your presence at every moment. As we come into this place now, we know we come into your presence and into your love, into your glory and into your power. Amen. If you'd like to take a seat. For those who haven't met me before, my name's Georgia. I'm the ordinand at St. John's, which means I'm training for ordination, training to be a priest in the Church of England, and I'll be leading our service this morning, and Reverend Chris will be bringing us the word later on. If you're new, you're very welcome, and if you're visiting, you're most welcome to be here. It's lovely to have you. Hopefully you've got a service sheet, and we'll be working through this in our service. And if you'd like to join in with the words in bold, please do so. The light and peace of Jesus Christ be with you. The glory of the Lord has risen upon us. And our lectionary psalm today is Psalm 150, And I thought it's a great psalm to include in our service because it's one that calls us to praise, calls us into worship. So shall we read this together? Praise the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in his mighty heavens. Praise him for his acts of power. Praise him for his surpassing greatness. Praise him with the sounding of the trumpet. Praise him with the harp and lyre. Praise him with the timbrel and dancing. Praise him with the strings and pipe. Praise him with the clash of cymbals. Praise him with resounding cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. And so if you're able, would you like to stand with me as we continue in this way of praise as we sing, Praise My Soul, the King of Heaven. Praise the God of grace, the one who came and died for us and rose again. And we come to a time of penitence, let us reflect on that. And our call to confession says, Christ, our Passover lamb, has been sacrificed for us. Let us therefore rejoice by putting away all malice and evil and confessing our sins with a sincere and true heart. And this call to confession invites us to rejoice within it, to not always see it as a solemn act, but to rejoice in this amazing gift of grace that we have all been given. So as we come to a time of silence, just to bring before God anything we would like to, you can dwell on the reminder that this is an act in our service, one that we can rejoice in. We'll just have a moment of quiet. Jesus Christ, risen Master and triumphant Lord, we come to you in sorrow for our sins and confess to you our weakness and unbelief. We have lived by our own strength and not by the power of your resurrection. In your mercy, forgive us. Lord, hear us and help us. We have lived by the light of our own eyes, as faithless and not believing. In your mercy, forgive us. Lord, hear us and help us. We have lived for this world alone and doubted our home in heaven. In your mercy, forgive us. Lord, hear us and help us. And Chris is going to come and bring us our absolution.
Good morning, and how wonderful that we praise the God of grace. Grace. He gives us what we could never ever deserve or earn, his gift of love and forgiveness. So may the Father forgive us by the death of his Son and strengthen us to live in the power of the Spirit all our days. Amen.
Amen. And shall we say our collect together? Risen Christ, for whom no door is locked, no entrance barred, open the doors of our hearts, that we may seek the good of others and walk the joyful road of sacrifice and peace, to the praise of God the Father. Amen. So we're going to continue in praise as we sing our next two songs, and we're going to sing them one after the other. The first one, Waymaker, and the second, Praise God from whom all blessings flow. So if you're able, would like to, do you want to stand with me as we come to continue in worship to our God? Would you like to take a seat? We come to worship the God who is our way maker and our miracle worker, and we are reminded of that as we come to read our scripture today, which Gloria is going to bring for us.
The first reading this morning is Acts chapter 5, verses 27 to 32. The apostles were brought in and made to appear before the Sanhedrin to be questioned by the high priest. "We gave you strict orders not to teach in this name," he said. "Yet you have filled Jerusalem with your teaching and are determined to make us guilty of this man's blood." Peter and the other apostles replied, "We must obey God rather than human beings. The God of our ancestors raised Jesus from the dead, whom you killed by hanging him on a cross. God exalted him to his own right hand, as prince and savior, that he might bring Israel to repentance and forgive their sins. We are witnesses of these things, and so is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading is John chapter 20, verses 19 to 31. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for the fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and said, and sighed. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands, and put my finger where the nails were, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here, see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you, Gloria. And Chris is going to come and bring us the word this morning.
Good morning. Morning, everyone. Very nice to see you. Bit of echo there, is that okay? Welcome if you're new being back at church, if you've been away for a while and this is your first time back in a while, And especially welcome. Lovely to see you. I hope you've really enjoyed the service today. We're going to look at this passage together. So let's pray before we start. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your written word to us in the Bible. And we thank you for your living word, the Lord Jesus. And we pray so much that this morning you would help us to believe that he is your son and Lord of all. He is who he says he is. In Jesus' name, amen. At the railway platform, there's a big crowd starting to gather. And there's quite a buzz around the place. The people gathering are mainly teenage girls. And you can see on their faces that they've been through a really traumatic time. It's been on the news that 10 months ago, these girls were kidnapped from their school. And they were held hostage by a terrorist group. Really awful experience. And for a long time, the public and their families feared the worst, that they'd never be released. But amazingly, the good news has come at last, that these girls have been released. They've been released. And here they are on this platform. They've come from their kidnappers, and they're now at the station, and they're ready to go home. They're safe now. They've got peace now. The train pulls up, and they move towards the doors. And you notice something strange happened at this point, is that one of the girls seems to take charge. And she stands in front of one of the doors to one of the carriages. And she says something to all the girls in front of her. She says, well, we've all been released, haven't we? And we've all got peace now. Brilliant. But I got here quickly. I got here a few days ago, in fact. And some of you have only just got here. You just arrived because you were delayed getting here from the kidnappers. So, because I got here days ago, I'm going to get into this nicer carriage. And if you've only just got here, well, go down to that nastier carriage down there. And you're listening and you're thinking, what's going on? So she goes in the carriage. And then a second girl comes to the front as well. And she stands on the step, kind of looking at, she talks again to the girls. She says, likewise, she says, well, we've all been released. And we've all got peace now. Brilliant. But in all those horrid months, do you remember, I never doubted we were going to get released. And I know that some of you really doubted at times. You almost kind of given up hope. Because I never doubted, I'm going to go in this nicer carriage. But if you doubted, then take that kind of nastier carriage down the bottom there, okay? And then she goes in. And again, you're thinking, what's going on here? And there's another girl. Another girl comes to the front, and she takes charge now. She stands by the door. And then she says something similar. She says, yeah, we've all been released. We've all got peace now. Brilliant. But do you remember, when we released, I was brave and excited, and I ran straight out. Some of you I know were really scared and panicked for a long time. Because I was brave and excited, I'm going to take this nicer carriage. If you were still scared at that point, take that kind of nastier carriage down there. And you're looking on, I think, what? This is strange. This is wrong, you're thinking, as you're watching on this. You think, I can't have this. So you decide to look for a kind of a big kind of loud hailer, you know, one of those things? Yep. So you grab that, and then you find a way to climb up on top of the train, onto the roof of the train, and you're looking down, and all the girls there are kind of waiting there, they can see you. And you shout down to them as loudly as you can, everyone, listen, this is ridiculous. Don't you remember what we've been through? We've been released from that. It doesn't matter how you got here. If you were delayed or you doubted about it, it doesn't matter. What matters is we're here. We've got peace now. We've been released. We all go in the same carriage. Why do I tell us that story this morning? Well, the writer John here in the Bible would tell us this morning, when it comes to believing in Jesus, it's not how you come to believe in him that matters. Whether you've taken a long time to come to believe him, or you've had so much doubt in the past, it's not what matters is who you believe in now. If we do believe in Jesus, we have peace now. We've been released from sin and death. How you got here, that doesn't matter as much. So we're going to go look through the reading we had a bit by bit to help kind of understand this. I would like us to look first at the end of the passage there. You might have noticed that this is verses 30 to 31. That is really the author John's, his big summary statement for his whole written gospel account. I don't know if you ever use a highlighter pen in your Bible. If you do, this would be a great one to highlight. It's a summary of his whole gospel here. Maybe don't do it in the church Bibles, but if you have one from home. Verse 30 says this. John writes this. This is his summary. Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these signs are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name. So is John, is he being vague about why he's written this account of Jesus? Is he being vague? No, he's being really clear. He wants people to believe. To believe that Jesus is God's Messiah, kind of his chosen king promised in the Old Testament. That Jesus is God, Son of God. Why? Because Jesus gives the gift of new life. So he's being clear, and that's good, isn't it? It's good that the writer's being clear. He wants you to believe. But what's he saying about how to believe in Jesus? Well, he's saying that it's by reading the signs that he's written. And for us, we read all about Jesus in the Bible. That's how you come to believe. But he doesn't say it's going to look exactly like this. You know, if you make a movie of you coming to believe, it's going to look exactly this, and everyone's going to have the same movie. No. Everyone has a different story about how they come to this point. John's clear. It's not how you come to believe in one sense that matters. It's just who you believe. Do you believe Jesus? That's his summary. Now let's look back over the rest of the passage to understand that more. Now it's worth remembering, of course, when this happens. When are we reading about? It's right after Jesus's first resurrection appearances. And these are life-changing moments for history, life-changing moments for every individual involved in this. So here we go. Let's go back to verse 19 from the start. And what we're going to see is that true belief in Jesus always brings you peace and purpose. Always. So verse 19. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. And again Jesus said, "Peace be with you." So can you remember how many times does Jesus say, "Peace be with you," in our whole passage? He just said it twice, and he says it to Thomas again later. Three times. "Peace be with you." Now, at home, if Karis, my wife, says something to me three times, I know it's important, and I need to listen. And I don't always do that very well. But Jesus is saying, "Peace, peace." What is this peace? Well, it is a greeting, yes, common greeting. But it's also... it's a gift being given. In an earlier chapter in John, Jesus promised God's divine peace to his followers. Peace given in the name of God the Father and given through the presence of God's Spirit in us and given through Jesus' victory over sin and death at the cross and resurrection. So we're saying that belief in Jesus always brings God's peace. Now, that's not just training your minds to think, think peace, and don't be anxious, It's not that. This is peace of a person. This is God in you now, that kind of peace. You see the difference there? And it's not just peace, because belief in Jesus also always brings you purpose. Purpose. So verse 21 again. Again, Jesus said to his disciples, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." So what's Jesus doing here? He's sending them out into the world around them. That's what he's doing. So that new peace with God actually brings them a new purpose in life. They are to carry God's Spirit in them, the Spirit of Jesus. They are to carry God's good news with them. The good news that the God of amazing, blazing purity has made a way to forgive, to wipe clean our inner evil, our sin. They're to carry that good news. And their role is to acknowledge that anyone is forgiven if they accept forgiveness. That's what kind of verse 23 means. I wonder if you can think of a more privileged purpose in life than that. There's no more privileged purpose in life than that, to carry God's Spirit, carry God's good news. You might be thinking, well, Chris, hang on a minute though. Was that purpose just for that first bunch of believers? No, it can't be. It can't be. Because Jesus has been really clear that this is not just going to be a kind of a one generation wonder. It's not going to just stop suddenly after this first disciples. It's going to go global. And it's not just a leader thing as well. If you're ordained or do paid, full-time Christian work in some way. No. This is an every believer thing. Jesus has been very clear about that. This is what the peace with God does. It automatically brings you that purpose. So true belief in Jesus always brings you purpose and peace. Let's think about ourselves for a moment, how to respond to this. Really, there is, of course, the key question for us all. And let's just think about this for a moment. The key question, of course, is for us, each of us, do you believe that the man Jesus is God's Messiah and is God the Son? He's God himself. Do you believe that? You might be thinking, well, no, actually, or not sure, actually, whether I believe that. Well, actually, realizing you think no or not sure, that's good to realize that. There's no point pretending about it. You've got to be honest about these things. But maybe ask yourself another question, would be this, perhaps, would I be willing to take a next step to think about belief in Jesus more? And if you think, yeah, I would be willing to do that, well, do tell someone. It's very easy to help each other out with that, to take that step. It's centrally important, Jesus says. What about for others of us? Again, the same question. Do you believe that the man Jesus is God's Messiah, is God the Son? If you're thinking, yeah, I do believe that, and I believe I need him, I guess that'd be most of us here this morning, of course. Well, praise God. Praise God. And in Jesus, God gives you, what does he give you? He gives you his peace. And he gives you his purpose. You have life in his name. And nothing you could do could ever be more precious or such a privilege than that. Let's move on now to think of what happened to the one of the 12, though, that wasn't there. Because not everyone was there. Thomas, he wasn't there. So what about him? See, we pick it up here from verse 24. You might want to read along with me. What we see here is that delayed belief, that's Thomas, delayed belief never disqualifies you. So from verse 24. Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, was one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands, and put my finger where the nails were, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Now I wonder instinctively, what do you think of Thomas here? Do you say, are you sympathetic to him? Thinking, well, he doubted, I've often doubted, you know, sympathetic. Are you maybe kind of slightly scoffing at him? It's like, he shouldn't have doubted. I wonder which of those. I mean, for me, I think I'm more instinctively sympathetic to him here. Probably because a couple of years after becoming a Christian, I had a big period, a kind of sinking feeling of doubt in different ways. So I don't know what it is for you. But notice several things here in the text. Really important here. Yes, Thomas's belief is delayed. It's a week later than the others. But his delayed belief does not disqualify Thomas in any way. You see? So he still gets God's peace. When Jesus says again, "Peace be with you," Thomas is right there. He's right there. Still gets God's peace. His delayed belief also is still true belief. It's still true belief. Verse 28, he declares in no uncertain terms. He says, "Jesus, my Lord and my God." So this is not a second-class belief. It's the same belief that the others have. And actually, on top of that, he's privileged as the first person in John's gospel to declare Jesus from his mouth as God. So his delayed belief is still true belief. He believes Jesus is his Lord and God. But even on top of that, his delayed belief still helps others to believe as well. So verse 31 we had earlier, John records this encounter as a sign for anyone who would read it, for us, to help us believe. His experience is helping us. And add to that, I don't know if you know about Thomas from history. After this, did Thomas kind of stick around at home and just put on Netflix for the rest of his life? No, he didn't do that. He took the good news and carried it beyond, and he ended up going to India, a long way away, and he, well, in God's kindness, God started churches there. The church in India grew because Thomas took the gospel there. So, do you see, his belief, it was delayed, but still, he received God's same peace and God's same purpose. Delayed belief never disqualifies or diminishes you in any way. So, well, yeah, for us, how do we take something from this for ourselves? Well, here's the important thing. If your story of coming to believe in Jesus it's taken a long time, maybe. Or maybe it's taken an unusual route, you feel, in some way. Or maybe you feel you've just been really full of doubt and really been really skeptical for a long time, maybe. Don't feel that that disqualifies or diminishes you at all. I was talking to someone in the church family just recently, over the past week or so, and you were saying that you've come to church, come to believe in Jesus, quite late in life, actually. You're kind of retired now, kind of a working life as you're retired from that. And I wonder, kind of maybe you're tempted to think, well, I feel a bit different. There are many Christians around the church who have been here, Christian. They've been Christians as long as they remember, from their earliest memories as a young kid, maybe. That's not me. I've come much later. And does that put me on the edge of things? Am I a lesser part of the community because of that? Do I have less purpose than other people here? Do I have to be in a kind of a different carriage to everyone else? Well, no, not at all, not in the slightest. Delayed belief, God never disqualifies you for it if you believe that Jesus is the Son of God. Let me just add a couple of really quick things from that. Is that one thing is that doubt can come back. Many of us would know that. That's nothing to be ashamed of. It's good to talk about that. Doubt is not uncommon for many Christians. Have you ever wondered why the Bible gives so many words of encouragement? It's because, you know, doubt is not uncommon for so many. And of course, part of this is don't look at other people's kind of delay or doubt in their belief. Don't look at them and scoff at them. Look down on them. Oh no, we can't do that. In fact, if your story of coming to believe in Jesus has been, you know, in some senses quite straightforward and in some ways, well, don't be puffed up by that. It's not to your credit. That's just God's kindness. I've been thinking for myself, definitely. God has really kind of prodded me with this over the past few days. I've been thinking about this. It's so easy to look down on others. It's so easy to feel other people looking down on you. Very easy. I'm prone to that. I'm sure we all are in different ways, of course. So what has God shown us today? It's not how you come to believe in Jesus that matters. It is who you believe. Do you believe that Jesus is God himself? John says, believe in Jesus. He says, that verse 31 again, these signs are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life, eternal life, life with God in his name. In his name. Believe in Jesus. He will always bring you God's peace, God's purpose. Delayed belief, well, he'll never disqualify you for that. Believe in Jesus. Let's pray together now. Heavenly Father, we praise you because you are eternal God. And we praise you for giving us your Son in the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you so much for him. You are so gracious to us. You don't hold our past against us. You don't hold our sin against us. Through Jesus, who has released us from sin and death as we trust in him. So, Father, help us to believe Jesus. If we have questions about that or nagging things about that, help us to look into it, to see why we would believe in him. And help us to treat each other as you treat us in the light of that as well. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Just as Thomas proclaimed, my Lord and my God, we're going to sing, he is the Lord, as we proclaim this as his church. And whatever the journey has been for you, whether it's been a journey of doubt, whether it's been a slow journey, whether you sit here today and you're still wondering what exactly it is that you believe, if you'd like to, and if you're able, would you like to stand with me as we sing this song, which does declare that Jesus is Lord and that he reigns on high. Would you like to remain standing as we say together our affirmation of faith, which is on the second page of our order of service? We believe in God the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named. We believe in God the Son, who lives in our hearts through faith and fills us with his love. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. If you'd like to take a seat, Vida's going to bring us our prayers of intercession.
Please bow down your heads and let's pray. O King of kings and Lord of lords, the great I am that I am, Master of the universe, King of kings and Lord of lords, the one who was and is to come, blessed be your holy name forever and ever. We thank you, merciful Father. We thank you for this day. We thank you for our lives. We thank you, Father, for all that you do and continue to do for us. We thank you, Father, that you are always with us in our going out and in our coming in our lying down and in our rising up. You're always with us. We thank you, Father, for your provision for us. Father, we thank you for this new season, for the spring, the flowers, the birds that sing, the glistening leaves, and the calm that we are enjoying, especially here in the UK and some parts of the world. We thank you, Father, for your mercies. Lord, in your mercy, King of kings and Lord of lords, we thank you for this church, for the opportunity to worship in comfortable surroundings and in peace. For that we are grateful. Lord, in your mercy, King of kings and Lord of lords, we bring before you Elizabeth, our queen. We thank you, Father, for adding another year to her life. We ask that you continue to strengthen her and give her peace, her and her household. Lord, in your mercy, King of kings and Lord of lords, we pray for our government and all those in authority. We ask that you continue to bless them with wisdom, to rule righteously, so that this country will continue to prosper and we will live here in peace. Lord, in your mercy, King of kings and Lord of lords, we pray for the church here and worldwide, for the Pope, Archbishop of Canterbury, for all those who work in the church worldwide, for missionaries, and all those who serve to proclaim your name in different ways. Lord, in your mercy, we also pray for the Woolwich Diocese, for Bishop Christopher, for Bishop Carraway, for Alistair, for the families of all those who lead the Church of England. Lord, in your mercy. And here at St. John's with Holy Trinity, Father, we pray for Reverend Chris and his wife, Callis, for Reverend Pat, Reverend Abigail and their families, for Christian, Georgia, Shola and their families, for our church wardens, Daniel, Bushola and their families, for the PCC, the Fabric Committee, for the Intercessory Prayer Group, for the Men's Group, Mothers Union, for the Youth Ministry, Sunday School, for the Welcomers, and administrator, for Herbert, our organist, for the choir, for all those who serve to make this church function in order. We ask, merciful Father, that you bless them, keep them, prosper the work of their hands, and give them peace, Lord, in your mercy. And merciful Father, we pray for this community, Lewisham, for all those who live and work here. We pray for the police, the fire brigade, for nurses and doctors, carers, for the social services, for all those who work in the parks to keep this area clean. We pray for teachers, for the food bank, and all those who serve in this community, and all the youth in this community, merciful Father, that you bless them and that there will be peace and no knife crimes, etc. Lord, in your mercy. Merciful Father, we pray for our youth, especially those preparing for examinations in different forms. We ask, Father, that you bless all their efforts and that they will succeed in their exams. And they will have cause to give you glory. Lord, in your mercy. And Father, for worldwide peace, we pray, especially for Ukraine at this time. King of kings and Lord of lords, when you saw the storms, you said, peace be still, and it was. So we pray, merciful Father, that you bring a swift end to this war. And we also pray for the people of Myanmar, that there will be peace in that area. For Sri Lanka, that there will be peace there. And in India, as they change the government, that there will continue to be peace. Father, worldwide, Lord, let your peace reign. Wherever there's turmoil, and we remember especially those in the Middle East, we remember Israel and the conflict between them and the Palestinians. You alone can solve this. We pray for peace in Africa, for Nigeria, Ethiopia, Congo, Cameroon, Sudan. Merciful Father, we pray for that which is happening in KwaZulu-Natal because of the flooding. We ask that you comfort those who have lost loved ones because of all this going on around the world. Many are crying out to you, merciful Father. We ask that you stretch forth your arm and touch, save, comfort, restore, and heal. Lord, in your mercy. And Father, we remember those who have put their names down. We remember Anna, Gwen, Joyce, Levita, Filipina, Vilma, Avril, Millie D, Iris, Tony LW and family, Connie and the Reverend Canon Olu, Lance and Josephine R, and the Reverend Sheridan James, Herbert, Carrie-Anne, and Natalie. Merciful Father, by your stripes, you said we are healed. And your word said, I am your physician. We ask, Father, that you touch all these souls and heal them even this minute, that they will know in their bodies that, yes, you are Lord, and in fact, you heal. So we ask that they will have cause to come and give praise and glory to your holy name. And we thank you, Father, that our brother, Chief Ofomata, is now at home. We thank you for touching and healing him. We ask that you complete that which you have begun. Lord, in your mercy, merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. And as our Savior taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you, Vida. Would you like to stand? We're going to share the peace with one another. And this peace which Chris was talking to us about, that Jesus gives each one of us. The peace of the Lord be always with you. So let's wave to one another and greet those around us with the words of the peace. I'm going to invite the wardens to come and bring us our news and notices this morning. If you'd like to take a seat, please do.
Good morning, everyone. Please turn to the back of your notice sheets for the notices today. There are a few dates for you for the diaries. Please remember that our AGM is on Sunday, the 22nd of May. So that will be after the service on the 22nd of May. We will have the AGM. And before that time, we will be updating the electoral roll. So this is your chance. If you're not on the electoral roll and you're over 16 years of age and you've been attending and worshipping here at St. John's or Holy Trinity over the past 6 months, then you're entitled to be entered onto the electoral roll of our parish. And that means that you will be able to vote in the AGM meeting. So from the 1st of May, our electoral officer, she's not here today, Yvonne, she's going to be updating the electoral roll. So if you need to go on the electoral roll, please attend on the 1st of May to see Yvonne, and she will give you enrollment forms for that. And also, if you're a leader in the church and you haven't yet submitted your report, please write your report this week and submit to Tamsin by the end of this week so that we can get the pack together for the AGM on the 22nd of May. On Saturday, 11th of June, there's a mistake on the service sheet here. It's a pilgrimage to Coventry Cathedral, not to Canterbury Cathedral, to Coventry Cathedral. So if you're interested in that, it's being organised by Woolwich Miac, and it costs £15, and they'll be leaving 8 a.m. prompt from Borough High Street. All are welcome. If you're interested, please speak to Shola for information about that after the service. Just to remind everyone as well, our church anniversary is coming up again, and it's going to be on Sunday, the 3rd of July. So that's just a date to add to your diaries. And today is when our old vicar, Reverend Peter Farley Moore, or Canon he's now, but he's going to be Archdeacon soon, will be sworn in as Archdeacon of Hackney. So if you're attending that today, it's going to be at St. Paul's Cathedral at 3 p.m. I know a lot of people aren't here today because they're going there at 3 p.m. But just to remind everybody that it is at 3 p.m. at St. Paul's Cathedral today. And I think that's it. Thank you.
Thanks. Thanks, Masuda. Yes, birthdays. Anyone have a birthday this week or last week? No one. We've had some busy weeks in the past this April, so this week is a quiet week. No one has any birthdays. Does anyone have any testimonies or anything they'd like to come and share with the church? We have a modest congregation this week, which is fine. No one has to come up the front. If not, you can save it for another week, that's fine. Do you want to stand with me if you can? And we're going to sing our final hymn, Salvation Belongs to Our God. And we'll be taking the offering in this next hymn. Pray, thanking God for your gifts and this offering. Lord God, we thank you for the generosity of your church, for this gift that we have before us. We pray that you'll be giving us the wisdom as to how best to use it to build your church and your kingdom, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you like to take a seat? We're going to have our closing prayers and then Chris will bring us the blessing. God of our salvation, you have restored us to life. You have brought us back again into your love by the triumphant death and resurrection of Christ. Continue to heal us as we go to live and work in the power of your Spirit to your praise and glory.
And so may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.
Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ. Amen.